investigating the wonderful rich tradition of singing sea shanties, all right? So through the lens of what it means to make music together and what it can do for each one of us when we sing together. You're gonna learn something, hopefully, that you don't know. You're gonna hear some music that you've not heard before. We have choral music, we have a little bit of lecture, we have soloists that have prepared and collaborated with student accompanists, student collaborative pianists in our piano department. It's gonna be a little bit of everything, so we're gonna have a good night. Please do not sit there and be stuffy, okay? If you hear something you like, cheer out. Clap wildly, enjoy yourselves, because that's what sea shanties are about. You'll learn that, of course, tonight. Come on down, we got seats in the front. This is wonderful. Good work, everybody. Great. It's gonna be a great night. We're gonna start with Codfish Shanty. Ready?
Thank you.
So what's fun about concerts is usually the way the audience responds in the first couple of pieces kind of sets the standard for what that's going to be like. So are we going to clap after the students do their lecture or not? What do we want to do? We won't let that half effort go for the rest of the time, so we'll just go all out.
All right, this shanty I'm going to be singing is called A-Roving. It was composed around 1600 and it was first performed around 1630. And it came from areas around like France, England, and Netherlands, that area. And that's about where agreement on the piece ends. In fact, even the lyrics are different depending on what version you have. And they have no idea where it actually came from. There's lots of argument about whether or not it was from a musical, and if it was from a musical, which musical? Some people have kind of opinions that they like to argue about. But the lyrics actually change the meaning of the song in a lot of cases. There's versions of this song where we have this really heartfelt love story that ends rather tragically, with this very sincere sailor, like, seeming to fall in love, and it seems to be going so well, and then just gets rejected at the end, and it's pretty sad. And that one kind of plays out melodically. It's nice. There's ones that have more of a Playboy sailor, where they seem to be falling in love, and then things take a little bit of a turn, and he gets rejected for a good reason. There's more still, where it's a rich sailor. The sailor's been working very hard, comes in with a very hefty paycheck, and is almost taken advantage of by a very cunning individual, and then gets out of it and goes back to the ship before he loses all his money, or maybe he does lose all his money. Depends on the version. The one I'm going to sing is of the Playboy variety. So there's a bit of a story there shown through the piano and some of the tone and dynamic levels. And it's called A-Roving One. That's the Roman numeral one. I don't want to take a chance of there being a roving one. But yeah.
Wonderful non-speaking from paper intro. I'm going to be up here a lot, so I will be speaking for paper. So I'm Greta Berner. I'm going to be performing Santy Anna in just a little bit. And this was created during kind of the 1800s. It commemorates the Mexican-American War and the efforts of the Mexican general and later president, Antonio Lopez de Santy Anna. Funnily enough, the original song, like Brenden's, is not very accurate to actual history. There's a lot of versions of it. Many verses are going to refer to conflicts of Santy Anna and American General Zachary Taylor, and specifically at two battles of Monterey and Molino del Rey. However, neither of these events actually occurred, as neither generals actually engaged in combat with each other, ever. Also, which will be in my version tonight, Santy Anna was not killed by Taylor. They, again, never met. And Santy Anna actually outlived Taylor by about 25 years. So they took some liberties. Furthermore, both of the previously mentioned battles are in the song described as Mexican victories. They were also American victories. So General Taylor ran away, which will be in my verse also untrue. The most puzzling thing that I found, though, was that the band who this supposed song is supposed to kind of laud, you know, when will we forget him, that'll be in there. He was quite a controversial figure, actually, and he was exiled twice during his presidency. Once during his loss at Molino del Rey in 1848, and then later due to political corruption in 1854. The most accurate part of the song for me is that in the verse that I will not be singing tonight, where it's compared to Napoleon, because they were both like these prominent leaders who were forcibly exiled. So, yeah. Okay.
In Scandinavian, French, German, and other European vessels, derived from the Anglo-American example in a characteristically international shipboard labor pool. The term likely derives from the French verb chanter, to sing, or its common form, chantette, to you sing.
That's me. All right, good job.
Were shantymen. These were oftentimes appointed leaders of kind of work shifts, and they were responsible for being the de facto soloists in a lot of genres, which I'll be discussing later, like evening shanties. And they were also just meant to lead the entire song with the men while working. There was no set selection to appoint a specific shantyman because it differed in the cultures between ship to ship and crew to crew. But a lot of the criteria stayed consistent, where they needed to be kind of experienced jack-of-all-trades. These were the head of work shifts for men. They needed to be authoritative. They needed to be respectable and witty and really, the big one, loud. They needed to be able to be heard over all that sea noise and men doing all that work and still get the song all the way into their ears. And wittiness was another really important characteristic because they were responsible for keeping songs really fresh and entertaining during these really long, arduous tasks that took forever, hours and hours and hours. So that's why a lot of the songs we're singing tonight have like 4,000 verses. Because they were just like, oh, let's try this tonight. So that is kind of our introduction into shantymen. Now we'll take away with our whole choir again.
That's pretty indisputable.
Because it's actually referenced as being a shanty in the first book that ever used the word shanty. G.E. Clark's 7 Years of a Sailor's Life tells stories of fishing off the coast of Newfoundland. And in one story, they're bringing up the anchor in a storm. And one of the songs that they sing in that story is called Paddy on the Railway. It's a capstan, which is a type of shanty named after a type of sail on the ship. So it's a work song. And I won't spoil the plot for you, but I do want to clarify that the story begins in Ireland, not in the U.S. It's easy for us to assume that every story starts here, but this one starts in Ireland. It will end up in the U.S. later. One word that you might not recognize in the last verse is the word cess, which is related to, in its origin, related to our word assess. So it means judgment, evaluation. And it will come up in the context of the last verse, which is kind of a weird verse. It doesn't fit into the rest of the song quite the same way that the other verses do, because every other verse of the song goes through years. It's a chronology. 1841, 1842, etc. And most versions end with Paddy going to heaven, or at least thinking about going to heaven, in 1847. But the version that Dr. Chism gave me takes a different route. The last verse is about how his sister's face is so ugly. So my best interpretation, I have to come up with some justification, is that the arc of this song is about how the oppression, the like bad experience of working on the railway in these years kind of wears him down to a point where he just hates everything. I landed on the
Paddy works on the railroad.
This well-known ship was capable of carrying over 200 passengers and operated between London and New York from 1846 to around 1858. Passenger lists prove its service as a passenger and mail ship on the London to New York route for that period. Registered at 899 tons by the builders, she was commonly sighted at 1,000 tons. The ship was severely damaged in 1865 while at anchor in New York, when the steamer Bridgeport collided with it and it was subsequently decommissioned. The shanty, Clear the Track, is associated in songs about her. Where and how this shanty originated is uncertain. There is no evidence that is, I should have actually read the Wikipedia entry, sorry about that. That it is Caribbean or African in origin. Bulgin was a slang term for a steam engine, and though most commonly used for trains, it was also used aboard steam ships. In this case, it could also be referring to the small locomotive which was used to haul ships through locks and canals. Alternatively, it may be evidence that the chorus was borrowed from railway work songs, a theory further bolstered by the Clear Away the Track and jaunting car lines. A jaunting car was a two-wheeled buggy pulled by a horse. In this context, it could be another holdover from railway terminology, although older versions of this song use the phrase low-backed car instead, which would make less sense in a railroad context. In this shanty, we will have mixed nautical imagery interspersed with references to rail cars. This combination of imagery strongly suggests the emergent and borrowed nature of work songs throughout this period. Smartest clipper, you can fly away, away. Are you most up? Is the Margaret Evans of the Blue Cross line so clear the track that the Bulgin run? Tibby a rig a jig in a jaunting car. Away, away. Are you most up? With Liza Lee all on my knee, so clear the track that the Bulgin run. Oh, the Margaret Evans of the Blue Cross line. Away, away. Are you most up? Never a day behind her time, so clear the track with the Bulgin run. Tibby a rig a jig in a jaunting car. Away, away, are you most up? With Liza Lee all on my knee, so clear the track with the Bulgin run. Oh, the curls are walking on the pier. Away, away, are you most up? And I'll soon be home to you, my dear, so clear the track with the Bulgin run. Ring a jig in a jaunting car. Away, away, are you most up? With miserly all on my knee, so clear the track that the Bulgin run. Oh, when I come home across the sea, away, away, are you most up? Eliza, will you marry me? So clear the track that the Bulgin run. Tibby a ring a jig in a jaunting car. Away, away, are you most up? With miserly
Jaunting. discussing hauling as types of shanties. So, with respect to function, shanties are classified into two main types, distinguished by the specific use and also, therefore, by rhythm and structure. So, hauling shanties, used for pulling, and heaving shanties, used for pushing. Hauling shanties are of four types. Monohull and haulyard shanties were used for hoisting topsails, the largest and heaviest aboard a square rigger. Also for other types of heavy hauling, and occasionally for rowing and other rhythmic chores of long duration. They are typified by a one-line call and response format, with a single line sung as a solo, followed by a one-line refrain joined by all hands. The crew would haul on the accentuated downbeats of the chorus, and one of the best methods of these is blow the man down, which so, secondly, short drag or short haul shanties were for hoisting smaller top gallants, royals, skysails, and other lighter sails, and for working sheets, clues, bunts, and braces to position square sails laterally. Rather than the prolonged rhythmic hauling of the long drag, the action here was lighter, shorter, or even hand over hand. Furling shanties were a small family of songs intended for furling sails aloft, which required a unified haul among several hands to gather, fold, and tuck along. Sweating up and hand over hand shanties used for setting jibs, staysails, and smaller square sails high aloft. While almost any haulyard shanty might do, the shanty that was particularly associated with hand-over-hand work is What Shall We Do with the Drunken Sailor, which you guys will get to enjoy in a tiny bit. It is probably the most famous shanty of all.
Okay, after the last time, I'll miss our connection that we formed over the last 3 minutes. So, as Chris referenced earlier, the final thing that I will be discussing with you is the subgenre of shanties, of heaving shanties. So these were songs that usually accompanied very long, specific tasks that dealt with quite literally heaving or winching ropes around a capstan to almost make like a pulley, and that would have a variety of functions that it would deal with, and that was pumping water out of boats, heaving anchor, loading ships, bringing them into port, and sometimes even like taking up loads of fish for whales or such as. And then in Santy Anna, which I sang, a notable English shantyman, Sam Hugel speculated it started as a pump shanty. And that would have been sung as they frequently pumped water out of wooden ships. However, as iron ships started to replace the wooden ships, that was less of an issue. And so it seemed to transition into a capstan shanty. And that was just, again, when the rope was ever wound around the capstan, that was a capstan shanty. The tasks were very, very arduous, and they relied on large groups of men. This would range from like 400 to 300, depending on how big the task was. These songs were structured to be a little bit longer. Some of these tasks could take hours. And so they would usually have long ballad sections that would be led by the shanty man I told you about earlier. And then that would be followed by grand choruses from the crew. And this would create kind of a call and response pattern that was a little bit more drawn out than hauling shanties. The notable examples, the biggest examples of this type of shanty are Shenandoah, which you will also hear tonight, and Rio Grande, which we will be performing right now.
Instead as you are. It's an American folk song dating to the early 19th century. The lyrics may tell the story of a roving trader in love with the daughter of an Indian chief. Most musicologists agree that the chief mentioned in Shenandoah is the Oneida Iroquois chief, John Shenandoah, who supported the English against the French in the Seven Years' War. Other interpretations tell of a pioneer's nostalgia for the Shenandoah River Valley in Virginia, and a young woman who is its daughter, or of a Union soldier in the American Civil War dreaming of his country home in the west of the Missouri River in Shenandoah, Iowa. The song is also associated with escaped slaves who were said to sing the song in gratitude because the river allowed their scent to be lost. There are few melodies as recognizable as that of Shenandoah. As with most folk songs, it's impossible to determine the song's exact origin. It has commonly been sung as a sea shanty, though it most likely originated with early French Canadian fur traders. Lyrics have been added and adapted by rivermen, settlers, cavalrymen, mountain men, and soldiers on both sides of the Civil War. Eventually, sailors on American clipper ships carried the song around the world, a song that speaks of the longing that we can all sense for a place that we love. In this spirit of collaboration and community, I invited four students to join me in presenting this piece. My name is Melissa Halverson, and I'm joined by Maggie Bick on piano, Nevaeh Gariepy on flute, Briella Duckett on violin. As we present Shenandoah, arranged by Samson Irish-Lodge.
Thank you. plane sitting its top sails after a week of strong headwinds. It's a very encouraging moment because you're finally getting underway, and the watch on deck tails to the halyards. This heavy topsail is hoisted in a long series of vigorous pulls, for which an appropriate shanty would be, row the man down. But that's on a good day. This is a little different. Doing the precisely same job in completely opposite circumstances when the wind is blowing directly at you and it's taking months longer than you would expect to get to where you're going, you'd sing something like Whiskey Johnny. This shanty is a halyard shanty, as we've described. It's a long-haul ditty, sung during heavy labor for an extended period of time. Usually the more demanding type of work that takes some setup before you start pulling. The story of this particular shanty is about a man who's pining for whiskey, while also being consumed by it because of its effects. As the singer, or I, will state, whiskey is the fuel that keeps him going, and is one of the few comforts he has in a harsh life at sea. The name Johnny refers to, there's usually one on every boat, or it can also refer to the people aboard boats in general, the mariners. And according to legend, Whiskey Johnny was most often sung when men were near a skipper or officer's quarters, hoping that the captain would be convinced to share a round with the crew. This is Whiskey Johnny.
Laborers were serving in the crews of merchant vessels in increasing number, bringing with them songs and age-old African singing traditions. These mingled with, haphazardly, with Anglo-Scots Irish genres, popular minstrel songs, parlor songs, and various other European and American musical influences, resulting in a distinctive occupational type. Shanty grew to maturity in the Industrial Revolution, notably in the cotton trade and North Atlantic packet trade from the 1820s to the American Civil War. Hard-nosed economic measures and the resulting depersonalization of maritime labor practices led many owners to ship the smallest possible numbers of men for their crews in order to save on wages and provisions. This left ships undermanned and made shantying all the more indispensable.
Mobility among the seafaring trades rendered shantying itself and the shantying repertoire virtually universal. The practice spread throughout through the merchant trades into the whale fishery and into European ships. Shanties were occupational work songs, seldom, if ever, sung for any purpose not connected with actually working the ship, with a few exceptions. As steam navigation gradually eclipsed commercial sail in the decades after the Civil War, shantying too descended into obsolescence. By the 1880s, 1890s, sail was relegated to carrying long-distance bulk cargoes, and by the 1930s had become virtually extinct. As early as the 1880s, shanties were being romanticized and popularized in arrangements for the parlor, glee clubs, and schools, like what you're seeing here. That brings us into one of the livelier ones that we're going to be singing. Drunken Sailor.
Notice in your programs it says choir plus audience. So, yes. Are you ready? Okay. Now, some of these rhythms are a little hard to get into the body, a little hard to get into the voice. Oh, this voice. So, folks, repeat after me. What shall we do with the drunken sailor?
What shall we do with the drunken sailor?
That will never do. All right, that will never do. Let's try that again. What shall we do with the drunken sailor?
What shall we do with the drunken sailor?
Well, we've got options, folks. They're on the screen behind you. They're also in your program. So we can repeat after me. Put him in the longboat till he's sober.
Put him in the longboat till he's sober.
Pull out the plug and wet him all over.
Pull out the plug and wet him all over.
Pull out the plug. I said, pull out the plug and wet him all over.
Pull out the plug and wet him all over.
It still wasn't right, but that's okay. Put him in the scuppers with the hosepipe on him.
Put him in the scuppers with the hosepipe on him.
Keep him by the leg and a running bowling.
Keep him by the leg and a running bowling.
A bowling is a type of knot. It's a type of knot. Hoist him up to the topsail yardarm.
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 Give him a taste of salt and water.
Give him a taste of salt and water.
Send him up the crow's nest till he falls down.
Send him up the crow's nest till he falls down.
We got options, folks. We got options. Now, you're going to join us in singing the chorus. As the spirit moves you, feel free to add harmonies to your liking. Goodness knows we will. At the end, where it says chorus three times, let us close it for you. You don't say we're going to start over.
What shall we do? Ready, watch out. What shall we do with a drunken sailor? What shall we do with a drunken sailor? What shall we do with a drunken sailor? Lying on the board.
Way, hey.
Way, hey, and up she rises. Way, hey, and up she rises. Way, hey, and up she rises. We're lying on the board. Put him in the longboat till he's sober. Put him in the longboat till he's sober. Put him in the longboat till he's sober. Way, hey, up she rises, way, hey, up she rises, way, hey, up she rises.
still do, right? We're here, aren't we? Life keeps climbing up and up, and even though it sucks, we're resilient, and we keep going. In the 16th century, Irish sailors sung Leaver Johnny as a way to rant about their frustrations and their terrible conditions, poor captains, and just all the like worries of the sea. And through this venting, they established a bit of camaraderie and, you know, a way they vent. You feel good after you vent. And through this, they vented. I get flat myself. It's been a long week. All right. Sailor sang Leaver Johnny as a way to rant, and this is specifically sung at the end of a journey, and they're pumping up all the water out of the boat and just getting ready to go home and see their families. This is going to be Leaver Johnny.
Someone over, blow meaning punch, or how we are going to treat the phrase tonight, to quickly finish off a drink, like throwing back a beer. Of course, there are many different sets of lyrics and stories to be told. The longest, the Johns, in their telling of the story, has an old sailor coming from Hong Kong, telling of how a ship captain kicking some drunken sailors off his boat. I don't know that that's the most realistic story, because in their live performances, they also sing the first two phrases of the SpongeBob SquarePants theme song. Like, our version will be telling the story, a little bit of a combination of a couple of stories. We start out with a ship setting sail over the bar, out of port, and encountering some hard weather, tearing the rags and the chains, the sails, and the rags being the sails, and the chains being the chains or ropes or whatever used to hoist up the sails. The captain then is rallying the sailors, saying, "The weather be hanged. We're going to sail despite these conditions." Next, we follow a sailor who is at port and finds a saucy young lady who shoots him down immediately. She claims to be none the better for having met him. I think that seems quite silly. Finally, we end off with a look at life, where sailors are tinkers and tailors are men. But life goes on, and the sailors will always return. So, we're going to live life to the fullest. Keep drinking, partying, and blowing the man down.
Oh, blow the man down, please blow the man down to be way, hey, blow the man down.
Limited space to get away from one another, for weeks and months and years at a time. Think of the isolation, think of the worry, think of the fear, think of the health concerns, the mental health concerns, the physical health concerns. So above and beyond hoisting sails and hauling gear, shanties were sung to keep these folks alive. These songs were sung because they kept people together in more ways than just work. Now, I don't know many of us that are going to need to go to our jobs on Monday and sing shanties to get through their shift. Well, actually, I sing sea shanties to get through my shift. But think of the worry that you may have right now. Think of the darkness that could be in your life, maybe. And think about the concept of singing as a means of health and wellness, right here, right where you are. We're not so far removed from the sailors in isolation, with worries and fears, with health concerns, with mental health concerns, and everything in between. So folks, we examine this genre of music because we live in a world that unfortunately is full of darkness and worry and fear and anxiety. But singing brings togetherness, and togetherness brings community, and community preserves health. So as you leave this space, I hope, of course, you've enjoyed what you've heard. We've got tremendous students. I hope you've learned something, of course. But most importantly, I want you to think about ways in which you can combat the darkness, whatever darkness you may have in your life, and we all have it. Think about what we can do, how we can celebrate community, how we can foster togetherness to create a better world. I want to say thank you to some folks here. First off, I want to say thank you. This has been a really great opportunity. We want to provide, always here at Whitworth, the best educational experiences for our students, one of which was creating some collaboration for our student accompanists, for our pianists. So I want to say thank you very specifically to all of our collaborative pianists this evening: Maggie Bick, Katelyn Parker, Eric Shaporda, Rebecca Shaporda, and Angela Tokarenko. Thank you for your work. Training them to do. So this is real boots on the ground experience. I want to thank you to our two additional instrumentalists, Briella, Duckett, and Nevaeh, Gariepy, this evening. Thank you very much. Of course, this ensemble does go nowhere without our tremendous Ponderosa Tenor Bass Choir collaborative pianist, Victoria Wu. Thank you for allowing us to be a part of your community. And as you go, remember to continue to make community a priority, because we are always better together.
Round of applause for Dr. Chisholm.
The ship was in the OT.
The wind blew up her bow down.